Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Persuade, the Four-Step Process to Influence People and Decisions, by Andres Lares and Jeff Cochran, with Shaun Digan, narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Publisher's note: in the print and ebook versions of this book, you will find visual elements, such as figures and tables and Appendix A and B. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. 1. The Art of Influence and Persuasion. Why did you buy this book? If you are like most of the people and organizations that have come to us for assistance over the last few decades, you likely bought this book because you want to persuade colleagues, sell more, convince bosses for more budget, motivate your staff, or communicate more effectively. Perhaps you are frustrated that you missed out on landing a huge account, were passed over for a promotion, or are having trouble getting colleagues to prioritize your projects. You know how important persuasion is, yet until now you did not know your success in this area was limited by your not having a process. Stick with us all the way through this book, and we promise, guarantee even, you will become more persuasive. And unlike any other book before it, your newly found persuasiveness will not be the result of memorizing a few tactics, but instead actually understanding why and how the brain works to improve performance in any future situation you may face. Humans have been studying the art of influence and persuasion for thousands of years. From ancient philosophers like Plato, Aristotle, and Cicero, to the thought leaders of today such as Carnegie, Cialdini, and Shapiro, the craft of influence and persuasion has fascinated humankind for centuries. Though there is likely more that we do not know than we do know, we have collected a wealth of knowledge on the power and process of influence and persuasion. This wealth of knowledge has come from philosophers, psychologists, economists, medicine, sociology, and other domains, all constantly wanting to better understand why people do what they do. To accomplish our promise, meaning to improve the way you persuade others, we will summarize the most relevant and supported research over the last two centuries, add the findings of our own extensive research and experience, and convert it all into a practical process, tools, and habits. What you are reading is the result of the following. 1. Over a decade of extensive research in this field by the three authors. 2. A pilot study and research study conducted by the authors that involved more than 1,000 decision-makers from all over the world, testing the various persuasion and influencing techniques referenced throughout the book. 3. Countless iterations to our model, tactics, and tools through training tens of thousands of people via various academic institutions and our corporate training firm, the Shapiro Negotiations Institute. SNI. Given that, and as you will quickly notice beyond this chapter, a tremendous amount of information is packed into this book. As a result, we recommend reading it in chunks, one chapter at a time, with the expectations that you will refer back to it when needed. Almost as if each chapter is its own short book. Though it will be an enjoyable read, it will also be challenging. To make this easier, we have included summaries at the end of each chapter and one at the end of the book to refer to again. Finally, to conclude this introduction, and before we go any further, we need to get one administrative item out of the way. Importantly, what is influence and persuasion? According to the Oxford Dictionary, influence is the capacity to have an effect on the character, development, or behavior of someone or something, or the effect itself. Persuasion is to cause someone to do something through reasoning or argument. Though both terms are not completely synonymous, we will use them fairly interchangeably and will refer to our definition, which is to cause someone to do or say something. So, without further ado, Jeff, Shaun, and I hope you enjoy the book and find it helps you improve your communication, persuasion, and influencing skills professionally and personally. Ethics of Influencing. You are negotiating with a terrorist, and the only way you can prevent him from setting off a bomb is to deceive him. Do you do it? Hopefully, you are not faced with this situation. However, this question is an example of many tough questions we face when dealing with the ethics of influencing and persuasion. Does the end justify the means? What role does intention play? Will this decision impact others? These are a few of the many fair questions we need to ask when we are working through the ethics of persuasion. This book will improve your ability to influence and persuade others, but with this improved skill comes a responsibility. Our hope, or more directly stated, our request, is that you use the information in this book with positive intentions, in a truthful manner, and respecting all of the other parties involved. A fine line exists between white hat and black hat uses for these tools, but we trust you will decide where that line belongs. This is a dynamic decision, one that you should think about while reading this book, as opportunities arise, and continuously address as needed. We cannot tell you where to draw an ethical line, but your being aware and thoughtful of this aspect will increase the likelihood the knowledge, tools, and tactics in this book are used the right way. The Tenets of Ethical Principles. The five tenets of the ethical principles of psychology is a simple method you could use to determine the ethical use of the concepts covered in this book. 1. Beneficence. Approach influence and persuasion with the intent to benefit others and do no harm. To do this, you must be alert to the wants and needs of others and balance these against your own motives and self-interest. 2. Responsibility. Your obligation to be loyal and faithful and do what you say. You must hold your end of any agreement and accept your own responsibility for the outcomes. 3. Integrity. Your dedication to use accuracy, honesty, and truthfulness in your pitches and arguments. You should not lie, use fraud, or deceive to elicit self-serving interests, and you should strive to correct any misconceptions that lead to mistrust. 4. Justice. The sense of fairness behind your outcome or intended outcome. In your attempts to influence and persuade, you should be looking for the win-win, where everyone benefits and there is no loser. 5. Respect. People have the right to privacy, confidentiality, and to their own self-determination. This means not taking advantage of people and allowing them to come to their decision without being manipulative or forceful. The Influence and Persuasion Process. As we previously mentioned, the study of influence and persuasion has been around for a long, long time. In approximately 350 BC, Aristotle, one of the most famous and impactful philosophers in human history, introduced the concepts of ethos, pathos, and logos, three elements of rhetorical persuasion which are the basis for many models we continue to use. Ethos is about a person's credibility and character, pathos is about appealing to the audience's emotion, logos is about using logic and reason. Since then, for thousands of years, philosophers, business people, marketers, entrepreneurs, agencies, negotiators, politicians, and many other professionals and organizations have used these concepts to persuade audiences. Today, one can find the triangle, shown in Figure 1.1, in many offices, textbooks, and websites. Since the early 2000s, our sales, negotiation, and influence training company, Shapiro Negotiations Institute, SNI, has studied and taught this concept. In 2005, SNI developed its own model based upon these principles, which you will see in this book. Since its first iteration, many aspects of the model have evolved, and rightfully so. Through our decades of experience, the growing body of scientific studies, and our own research, we have tweaked our tools and techniques, developed new exercises, and evolved our methods and model using this knowledge to advise people and organizations all over the world. All of this has led Jeff, my partner in the business, Shaun, a friend and fellow researcher, and myself, to write this book. We chose to base our influence and persuasion model and our influence without authority training program on Aristotle's concepts because they are strong, simple, and actionable. However, we felt compelled to update this model for two key reasons. One, the world and how we understand it has changed. Around the time that Aristotle proposed these concepts, Alexander the Great was in his prime. Wars were constant, and if you were a man of age, you would almost certainly be drafted into the army. When not at war, you might attend symposia, which were drinking parties that lasted for days. Attending public trials commonly ended with the execution of those found guilty. Gender and socioeconomic status defined who you were. If you were poor, you were unable to vote or get an education. If you were a woman, you probably did not control your life. Instead, your father, brother, husband, or son controlled it. Since that time, we have evolved in the way we interact and in our knowledge of the most effective ways to communicate, influence, and persuade. Two, Aristotle's philosophies needed adaptation to become a practical process. Aristotle did not address when to use ethos, pathos, or logos. When are they appropriate? Is there an order? How do I build credibility? What emotions should I engage? These were all the questions we felt needed to be answered more specifically in a model people and organizations could implement to improve their influencing abilities and performance in a sustained and repeatable fashion. Figure 1.2 shows the four-step process of influence and persuasion based on over 15 years of research, analysis, and experience. In 1943, American psychologist Dr. Abraham Maslow famously published his controversial Hierarchy of Needs in the form of a pyramid, which described how humans are motivated by basic needs first and then work their way up from there. Similar to Maslow's hierarchy of needs, we use a pyramid to represent the hierarchy of the influence and persuasion process. The pyramid is built in such a way where each layer is built upon what comes below. In our case, building credibility is the first step in persuading someone. Without it, the other party will not care enough or not put enough stock in whatever you do or say to be influenced. Second, engaging the other party's emotion is what allows you to impact the way they think or behave. Though difficult to do, you can do it, and we will show you how. Third, and only then, does logic play a role in the influencing process. Our years of research and experience have shown us that the timing and the way logic is used is the most common mistake people make when persuading others. Finally, facilitating action. This was not in Aristotle's notes, but a product of the research and many iterations of development we discussed. This is the extra step that allows you to reap the fruits of your influencing labor. Our book will use some of these principles to influence you into using this process. We will share countless sources to support our claims, as well as the results of our own research to demonstrate our expertise in the field. We will leverage stories to engage you emotionally and give you a sense of the practical nature of this process. We will provide our evidence in a succinct and persuasive manner so you can see how it works and easily use it yourself. Finally, we will provide you with summaries and other tools throughout the book to make it easy for you to use it to obtain results quickly. 2. Building credibility. People want an authority to tell them how to value things, but they choose this authority not based on facts or results. Michael Burry, hedge fund manager featured in the movie The Big Short. Michelin Restaurant, New York Times bestseller, directed by Steven Spielberg. If this is all you knew about a restaurant, book, or movie, would you be inclined to pay for it? Notice how quickly you can establish credibility. By the same token, put the words felon, discredited, or disbarred before a description and see what happens. Before any attempt to influence people or before any decisions are made, you must establish you are credible, that you are believable and people can trust you. It does not matter how logical your reasoning is. If you are not credible, then you are unlikely to be convincing. In other words, without credibility, the message will not get through. This is because people are often persuaded not by the logic, but by whom it is coming from and how it is communicated. Thus, building credibility is the first step in the four-step process of influence and persuasion. In this chapter, you will learn how credibility is built, along with tips and tactics to establish your trustworthiness and expertise. Credibility, trust, and expertise. To learn how credibility is established, we need to understand what it is. Credibility refers to the quality or power of being trusted and believable. Establishing credibility entails someone having faith in you as a person, your intentions and integrity, and believing in your ideas and suggestions. To establish trustworthiness and faith in you as a person, you must show you warrant it, that you are honest and can be trusted, are genuine, sincere, and consistent, and will do what you say you will do. Though trust is required to be credible, it alone is not usually enough to persuade. You can be a trustworthy person, but that does not mean your ideas are worth listening to, and even less, worth meriting action. The second core aspect of credibility is being deemed to have sufficient related knowledge or skills about the topic. The importance of credibility and expertise can be seen in the credibility equation. Credibility equals trust plus expertise. How important are trust and expertise? One recent study by scientists at City University of London found that trustworthiness, expertise, organizational role and experience, and approachability were the three top factors in who one deemed as credible and someone he or she would go to for advice. In their study among Australian intensive care unit nurses, they found that even when making the type of life or death decisions facing them in the critical care settings in which they work every day, these nurses relied on the credibility of the person providing them information more highly than on the information itself. Building trust. Have you ever wondered why we are so quick to trust one person and not another? For example, why is it that we might walk into a retail store and say, "just browsing," before the staff members even open their mouths, yet we will drop off our car at a repair shop and not question the mechanic when we pick it up? Ultimately, this comes down to trust. At a company level, this can play the same role. Think of how much time and money Apple, Gucci, Coca-Cola, and other companies spend creating a brand you trust. You buy the next iPhone expecting it to be powerful and easy to use. You drink a Coke expecting to know the taste. And you assume the Gucci handbag will last forever because of its branding. This same is done on a personal level. People can and will Google you to gain their first impression of you based on your online presence, positive or negative, before you meet. Now that we know what credibility is, we need to further delve into the trust component that drives it. The impact of trust cannot be overstated as it relates to influencing and persuading others. In fact, research suggests that trustworthiness is the most important characteristic that someone would describe in an ideal person. So how do you build trust? Over our years of experience and advising others, we have seen some consistency around how people build trust, identifying four key components: connection, value, reliability, and self-interest. From these components, we came up with the trust equation. Trust equals connection plus value plus reliability over self-interest. Let us dig into each of these further. People often determine how much they trust others in part because of their connection with the other person. Connection has to do with the strength of the relationship. In everyday language, it could be described as whether you gel with someone. This comes from mutual understanding, shared interests, alignment in priorities, etc. Research tells us that spending more time with someone makes a connection more likely to develop. The more often you engage and the more personal those engagements tend to be will determine how much trust is derived from your connection with others. While knowing this is helpful, we will share various ways to speed up and shortcut this process throughout this book. To gauge your connection with someone, think about how you would rate the overall connection and ask yourself, do I communicate often? Do they reach out, or am I always the instigator of conversations? Who typically ends conversations? Do they smile when they speak with me? The value you bring to the relationship is another strong determinant of trust. The higher the value that someone perceives you bring to the relationship, the more they will trust you. To assess the value you bring to a relationship, ask yourself, do I freely offer your expertise and advice? Does the other party use or reference any ideas or resources I have shared? Is the value I provide consistent? Another important determinant of trust is reliability. Reliability refers to the belief that you will do what you say you will do. Simply put, if you cannot be counted on to do what you say you will do, the other person is unlikely to trust you. To gauge others' perception of your reliability, consider whether you have a history of following through on what you say, finishing projects on time, and generally being consistent. Finally, these factors are balanced by others' views of your own self-interest. To gauge this, ask yourself, does the other person feel I am only seeking self-gain? Have I demonstrated interest in their wants and needs? Would I be willing to make any sacrifices for their benefit? As a final note about trust, other characteristics are associated with trustworthy people. Here is a list of the most common that you can tap into to develop trust from others. Characteristics associated with trustworthiness: honesty, responsibleness, optimism, sincerity, consistency, selflessness, respectfulness, reliability, authenticity, humility, dependability, generosity, caring, benevolence, kindness, gratefulness. The nonverbal communication signals of trustworthiness. In addition to the behavior and traits you display, how you say something matters. Research has found that nonverbal communication skills, such as the pacing of speech, eye contact, whether or not you smile, and appropriate attire, are all related to how trustworthy someone is seen. We will talk more about nonverbal communication, that is, body language, in Chapter 7, where we devote the entire chapter to body language and nonverbal communication. For now, here are some tips on building trust through nonverbal communication. Pay attention to your speech. If you are a fast speaker, you will want to slow down. Research has shown that speaking quickly can make the other person feel pressured. Also, pay attention to your pitch. While lowering one's pitch is a common way to attempt to convey authority, speaking in your natural pitch is seen as more authentic and a communicator of trust. Make more eye contact. Studies have shown that eye contact evokes feelings of trust by showing you like the other person and are actively listening. Smile. Smiling is another useful way to cultivate trust. Smiling conveys liking, especially while maintaining eye contact, and research shows that authentic and genuine smiles impart the perception of trustworthiness. Mirror the other person's body language. Matching the other person's stance, gestures, and facial expressions has been shown to convey empathy and trustworthiness. We will discuss mirroring in more depth in the next chapter. The neuroscience of trust. Trust appears to be hardwired into our brains. Research has found that the hormone oxytocin increases your impulse to trust others. Oxytocin, or the love drug, is a hormone that acts as a chemical messenger in the brain. Oxytocin has been found to play an important role in mating, childbirth, and breastfeeding, and has been associated with empathy, trust, happiness, generosity, intimacy, and relationship building. Neuroscientist Dr. Paul J. Zak has been studying the role of oxytocin on trust for the past 2 decades. In one experiment, Zak developed an exercise called the Trust Game, in which participants were assigned one of 2 roles, senders or receivers. The senders were given $100 of hypothetical money and asked to send it to anonymous recipients via computer. Senders were also told the recipients would receive 3 times the amount that was sent, and the receivers would then choose whether and how much to share with the senders. Zak found that the more money people received, denoting the more the senders trusted them, the more oxytocin was produced in the receiver's brain. It was a confounding process, as that led those recipients to share more, living up to the trust the senders bestowed on them. According to Zak, the biological basis for social connections, oxytocin, is part of the brain mechanisms that serve to make us happy. In other words, interacting with others, building connections, and being trusted makes us happy. In turn, this increases the oxytocin in our brains, leading to an increase in our own willingness to trust. However, the influence of oxytocin on trust is not always the same. Dr. Moira Michalajek of the Catholic University of Louvain believes that oxytocin is not the magical trust elixir described in the news, on the internet, or by some influential researchers. The relationship between oxytocin and trust is highly contextual. When Michalajek conducted a modified version of the trust game, she found that though oxytocin increased trust when participants were given cues recipients were trustworthy, oxytocin did not increase trust when the participants were given cues recipients might be untrustworthy. Michalajek's takeaway was that oxytocin makes people trusting, not gullible. Trust equation score. Try calculating your trust equation score. Think of someone with whom you have a real business relationship. Consider the connection, reliability, and value that each of you bring to the relationship, and then assess the level of your trust by calculating your trust equation score. To calculate your trust equation score, rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 5 points on the connection, value, and reliability that you believe the other party would describe you as bringing to this relationship. For each of connection, value, and reliability, a low score represents your belief the other party would rate you low in the amount of connection, value you bring to the relationship, or reliability. A higher score represents your belief that the other party would rate you high in these areas. Now give yourself a rating on a scale of 1 to 5 as to where the other party would rate you in terms of your self-interests. Here, a low rating means you believe you would be perceived as less self-interested and/or concerned about the other person's best interests. And a high score means you believe you would be perceived as highly self-interested. To summarize, For each of the three aspects above the line, a higher score is better, and for the one below the line, lower is better. Now go ahead and calculate your trust equation score as shown in Figure 2.3. 0 to 5, low trust signals a weak relationship where connection, reliability, and value all may be low and perceptions of your own self-interest may be high. 6 to 10, medium trust signals a relationship with a moderate amount of trust, but where some trust factors could be improved. 11 to 15, high trust represents a strong relationship with a high amount of trust. One or two areas may exist for improvement, but you are likely perceived as highly trustworthy. To get the most out of this exercise, notice where you scored the lowest with this person and work on improving those aspects of your relationship. To improve your overall relationships, repeat this exercise for several people you know and look for any common trends. Perhaps you will see one or two areas where you are consistently low, and you can focus on those aspects of your perception to change your image. The liking effect. Have you ever noticed that most people tend to typically like people who are similar to themselves? It is true. Birds of a feather do flock together. Study after study has found we are more inclined to like people who look like us and share our interests, attitudes, or other commonalities. Finding similarities is the bridge that brings people together. Although there are several explanations for this, part of the reason is because we are attracted to familiarity. We tend to know and understand things familiar to us. There is less uncertainty, more of a feeling of safety, which, in turn, leads to a greater willingness to trust. Similarities also help us validate ourselves and our own interests and attitudes about the world. They confirm and verify our self-concepts and make us feel good about ourselves. Thus, to increase liking and increase trust, look for similarities. Want to know another secret to get someone to like you? Like them. In psychology, this is known as the reciprocity of liking. When we believe people like us, we are more likely to like them back. This is part of the reason warm greetings and positive first impressions are so important. Showing people you like them paves the way for them to like you, and in doing so, to trust you more and act more trustworthy. Pro tip: another way to build trust is by telling a personal story. Personal stories make you seem more human and likable. Stories give you an opportunity to find ways to connect with your audience. They make you seem authentic. In one study by researchers from the University of Missouri, they found people were most receptive to information when someone communicated a personal story. In their study, they asked participants to judge the credibility of scientists communicating information on plant science, a non-controversial subject. What they found was that when the hypothetical scientists included a personal story on how they became interested in plant science, they were deemed more credible and authentic than when the information presented contained no personal backstory. We discuss storytelling more deeply in Chapter 3. Until then, think about how you can use stories to highlight your own trustworthiness. Tapping into nostalgia. Jeff has a story on increasing liking by invoking one special emotion, nostalgia. Here is Jeff's learning experience using a rather odd smell to increase his credibility. In thinking about the research that indicates how the sense of smell is the sense most associated with memory and emotion, I thought about a time when, while customizing a program, I unknowingly tapped into it. In preparing for programs, we will often do whatever is necessary to relate to the individuals to whom we will be presenting. If we are speaking to salespeople, we will go on a ride-along with a few of them to get a sense of the real-life challenges they face. That approach has given me the opportunity to enjoy different experiences. I have stood in clean rooms where they manufactured pharmaceuticals. I have tested outerwear equipped with a special tracking sensor that is activated in an avalanche. I toured a family-owned operation that processed 3 million hogs per year. But the smell that allowed me to connect with participants the most was formaldehyde. I was about to present a program on persuasion and negotiation to a group of medical device salespeople who convinced surgeons to use their device during surgery for the hemostatic sealing of tissue at the surgical site. Part of their job was to gain enough credibility that they were allowed into the operating room. At the critical moment, they would interrupt the surgeon and suggest not using the device on which they had learned their skills, and pick up the rep's company's device for a preferred patient outcome. I had gone on multiple ride-alongs, and one thing was obvious. The confidence a rep needed to be so bold as to tell a surgeon what tools to use during surgery precluded a lot of input from individuals who had never done the same. But I needed to bond and establish credibility with these folks if I were to have any chance of leading a learning session for them. I could not imagine how I was going to connect. Until I had a perfect stroke of good luck. 6 weeks before the session, I received a call from the logistics contact in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. She was calling to let me know that rather than meet at her home office in Portsmouth, we would instead be meeting in Indianapolis, Indiana. "Why the change?" I asked. She said the members of the training session were going to be attending a cadaver lab the day before the training started in Indianapolis. "Cadaver lab?" I asked. She explained they had 2 teaching orthopedic surgeons and 12 salespeople who would attend the cadaver lab all day to simulate an authentic sales call. She heard the interest in my voice and offered me the chance to join them. I leapt at it. The morning of the mock surgeries, I think that I was the first one at the lab. We would be in 2 groups of 6, and one group would perform an anterior hip replacement with Dr. So-and-so, and the other group would perform a routine back surgery on the lumbar section. In the second round, we would switch. So the doctors led us through the whole routine. We scrubbed in, gowned up, donned masks, before they were fashionable, circa 2020, and went to work. There were a lot of memorable parts to it. I remember the surgeon coaxing the reluctant participants to take their turn incising the skin. I remember the sound of the special medical power drill, sounded like my Stanley, whirring as it prepared the socket to receive the artificial hip's ball joint. But the sense we remember was the smell. 6 weeks later, when we assembled for the training sessions with the salespeople who had been through the cadaver lab, the common bonding point was the smell. In the first 5 minutes of the first day, and reflecting on what they had done weeks before at the cadaver lab, I would look at participants and comment, "How about that smell?" Noses would wrinkle and memory banks would flood, and I would have instant credibility based on the scent of formaldehyde. All in the session would begin to buzz about their personal experiences in the lab. Sure, we would talk about the blue scrubs and the awkward gloves, but the one thing over which we all bonded was the smell. The smell was the evidence we had experienced the same thing. For credibility, smell was the litmus test, because hardly anyone can fake the memory of a smell. Later, as we researched to prepare for this book, we discovered why. It turns out that smells are related to parts of the brain associated with long-term memory and emotion, one of the reasons scents evoke the feeling of nostalgia. So there you have it. Smells evoke nostalgia, and nostalgia is a strong, pleasant emotion which leads to bonding. If you are ever in a fix for bonding with someone, find out what smell they remember best to increase linking. Pro tip. To establish rapport more quickly, ask about people's interests. Find out what energizes them and what irritates them. What makes them tick? Ask about what they do in their free time, their hobbies, or their favorite movies. These types of questions allow you to get to know someone more quickly and find similarities. Research has shown that 1. Talking about oneself makes people happy, and 2. These types of questions are likely to make people feel closer. This can be especially useful in the virtual world, where establishing rapport and closeness is more challenging. The four key components for building trust. As we discussed at the beginning of the building trust section, four key components exist for building trust: connection, value, reliability, and self-interest. Now that you've learned about how nonverbal signals, neuroscience, the liking effect, and nostalgia are related to trust, let's revisit the four key components. 1. Focus on building a connection. Make sure you focus on the person when providing your solutions. 2. Be reliable. Do what you say you will do and even give yourself extra opportunities to do so. 3. Provide value. Every time you speak with someone, seek out ways you can increase the value you bring to the relationship. 4. Be selfless. Always remember the best interests of everyone at the table. Putting these core components into action is the key to building trust with people in every relationship. Establishing expertise. Blueberries are good for you, says the cashier at your local grocery store. Blueberries are good for you, says the head of internal medicine at Johns Hopkins Hospital. Whose opinion impacts you more? Though you don't know either, the expertise you believe a person has in the content domain makes a world of difference in how much credibility they have. The cashier's opinion is fine, but it does not carry the same weight as someone you likely deem to be an expert in the field. So the question becomes, how do you put yourself in the position to be more like the latter than the former when influencing others? This is why the second major factor in building credibility is establishing knowledge and expertise. However, general knowledge and expertise will not suffice. Though trustworthiness may translate as an important part of credibility in all social situations, the knowledge and expertise you display must be directly relevant to the situations and decisions you are building credibility to influence. 1. Identify your expertise. The first step in establishing your expertise is identifying how your knowledge is relevant to your ideas, solutions, and proposals. Think about the types of projects you are drawn to, what you are good at, and the type of advice people come to you for. For example, Jeff, Shaun, and I have been working in the fields of influence, persuasion, negotiation, and communication for decades. These are our areas of expertise. 2. Claim your expertise. The next step in beginning to establish your expertise is to claim your expertise. Claiming your expertise is telling yourself and others where your expertise lies and how it is related. An important part of claiming your expertise is believing in yourself. Confidence sells, and how you introduce, describe, and carry yourself matters in establishing your expertise. For example, over the last decade, Jeff, Shaun, and I have been claiming our expertise, conducting research, publishing articles, and working to develop our expertise in these areas. 3. Show your expertise. Now that you have claimed expertise, you need to support it by demonstrating your expertise. One way is to generously give advice in your area of expertise. Being a part of the conversation is important. This could include joining industry groups or associations, professional groups, and groups on social media. Another way to show your expertise and join the conversation is to create, curate, or share valuable content in your domain. For example, as members of various organizations, teaching and guest speaking at academic institutions all over the world, training and consulting with global leading companies, and consistently being sourced by various publications such as Forbes, CNBC, Harvard Business Review, and the Sports Business Journal, Jeff, Shaun, and I have many examples we can use to show our expertise. 4. Develop social credibility. Once you have claimed and shown it, the next step is to get some social verification. This means gaining acknowledgement and support from others who agree you are credible in your domain. Depending on your field and expertise, you may build social credibility through formal acknowledgement. Formal acknowledgement can take the form of accreditations, awards, certificates, degrees, or other former acknowledgement of your accomplishments or knowledge. For example, all of our hard work has paid off, and we have developed a depth of social credibility thanks to teaching awards, best presenter awards, testimonials from clients, and many other sources of social credibility where others vouch for the quality of our work. 5.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.